Hello! In this lecture, we'll briefly cover the physics of motion and energy, including Newton's laws of motion and the universal law of gravitation. I won't cover everything in Chapter 4, but there should be enough physics here for you to understand and hopefully appreciate more deeply the wide-ranging astronomical phenomena that we'll encounter in this class. Physics is beautiful. I know I'm biased, but still, what other subject allows us to predict the motion of objects throughout the universe? Whether it's the throw of a baseball or the precision landing of a rover on Mars, we can use physics to precisely determine where things will end up. For example, these two spiral galaxies are on a collision course. We can predict the motions of their stars as the galaxies approach one another over the next tens of millions of years. It's pretty neat, right? We won't spend a lot of time here, but I want you to obtain some of the basic vocabulary for describing motion. First, speed. The speed of anything tells us how far it will go in a certain amount of time. For example, 70 miles per hour is a speed. If it's the speed of your car will go 70 miles in 1 hour. Velocity tells us both speed and direction. For example, the boat is going 10 meters per second due east. An object is accelerating if its velocity is changing. It's the velocity per time, so the units are distance per time squared. You are probably familiar with acceleration as it applies to increasing speed, but you are also accelerating if you are turning, because turning changes your velocity. It changes your direction. If you are slowing down, you are accelerating too. You can often feel the effects of acceleration. For example, as you speed up in a car, you feel yourself being pushed back into your seat. As you drive around a curve, you feel yourself being pushed away from the direction of your turn. And as you slow down, you feel yourself being pulled forward from the seat. In contrast, you don't feel such effects when moving at constant velocity. One of the most important types of acceleration is the acceleration caused by gravity. In a legendary experiment, Galileo supposedly dropped weights from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. He demonstrated that gravity accelerates all objects by the same amount, regardless of their mass. This fact may be surprising because it seems to contradict everyday experience. A feather, for example, floats gently to the ground while a hammer plummets. But it's air resistance that causes this difference in acceleration. If you dropped a feather and a hammer on the moon, where there is no air resistance, they would fall at exactly the same rate. The acceleration of a falling object is called the acceleration of gravity, abbreviated g. On Earth, the acceleration of gravity causes falling objects to fall faster by about 10 meters per second with each passing second. For example, suppose you drop a rock from a tall building. At the moment you let it go, its speed is 0 meters per second. After 1 second, the rock will be falling downward at about 10 meters per second. After 2 seconds, it will be falling at about 20 meters per second. In the absence of air resistance, its speed will continue to increase by about 10 meters per second each second until it hits the ground. We therefore say that the acceleration of gravity is about 10 meters per second, or 10 meters per second squared. In daily life, we usually think of mass as something you measure with your bathroom scale. But technically, the scale measures your weight, not your mass. The distinction between mass and weight is important in astronomy. Mass is the amount of matter in an object, and weight is the force that acts on an object. It's the force that the scale measures when you stand on it. It's your weight. To understand the difference between mass and weight, imagine standing on a scale in an elevator. Your mass will be the same no matter how the elevator moves, but your weight can vary. When the elevator is stationary or moving at constant velocity, the scale reads your normal weight. Now consider an elevator moving at constant velocity. In this elevator, you will also see your normal weight on a scale. If an elevator accelerates upward, the floor exerts a greater force than it does when you are at rest. You feel heavier, and the scale verifies your greater weight. If the elevator accelerates downward, the floor and the scale exert a weaker force on you, so the scale registers less weight. Remember, this only happens when the elevator is accelerating. If the elevator cable breaks, the elevator and you are suddenly in free fall, falling without any resistance to slow you down. The floor drops away at the same rate that you fall, allowing you to essentially float freely above it. The scale reads zero because you are no longer held to it, and the free fall has made you weightless. You are in free fall whenever there's nothing to prevent you from falling. Jump off the table, you are in free fall, but only for a second. You've probably seen videos of astronauts floating weightlessly in the space station or space shuttle. They are weightless clearly, but it's not because of a lack of gravity. There is gravity in space. They are weightless because they are in free fall. Astronauts orbiting Earth are in a constant state of free fall. To understand this, imagine a tower that reaches all the way to the space station's orbit. If you stepped off the tower, you would fall downward, remaining weightless until you hit the ground. We're ignoring air resistance here. Now imagine that instead of stepping off the tower, you ran and jumped out of the tower. You'd still fall to the ground, but because of your forward motion, you'd land a short distance away from the base of the tower. The faster you run, the farther you go before landing. If you could somehow run fast enough, an interesting thing would happen. By the time gravity had pulled you downward as far as the length of the tower, you would have already moved far enough around the Earth to notice the curvature of the planet. That is, as you fall towards Earth, it curves away from you. You are in orbit. The space shuttle, space station, and satellites are all orbiting Earth because they are constantly falling. Here's another way of seeing it. The Earth's curvature drops a vertical distance of 5 meters for each 8,000 meters tangent to the surface. So to orbit Earth, a projectile must travel 8,000 meters in the time it takes to fall 5 meters. Isaac Newton. We could spend the whole semester talking about his work. He published his laws of motion and gravity in 1687 in his book, Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, or his Principia. His laws govern the motion of everything from our daily movements on Earth to the movements of stars, planets, and galaxies throughout the universe. Newton really did change our view of the universe, and oh my, just look at that hair. Now, the story is that when Newton saw an apple fall to the ground, he suddenly realized that the gravity making the apple fall was the same force that held the moon in its orbit around Earth. The same laws that operate on Earth also operate in the heavens. Newton's work completely revolutionized mathematics and science. He quantified the laws of motion and gravity. He conducted experiments regarding the nature of light, built the first reflecting telescopes, and he invented calculus. Let's talk about Newton's laws of motion. Newton's first law of motion essentially restates Galileo's discovery that objects will remain in motion unless acted on by an outside force. In other words, objects at rest tend to remain at rest, and objects in motion tend to remain in motion with no change in their speed or their direction. A spaceship, for example, needs no fuel to keep moving in space. Newton's second law of motion tells us what happens to an object when a net force is present. This law explains why you can throw a baseball farther than a bowling ball. Because the mass of the bowling ball is greater, the same force from your arm gives the bowling ball a smaller acceleration. It's just harder to throw something more massive. Astronomically, Newton's second law explains why a large planet, such as Jupiter, has a greater effect on asteroids and comets than a smaller planet, such as Earth. Because Jupiter is much more massive than Earth, it exerts a stronger gravitational force on passing asteroids and comets, and therefore can send them scattering with a greater acceleration. Are you sitting down right now? If so, your weight is exerting a downward force. If this were the only force, Newton's second law would demand that you accelerate downward towards the center of the Earth. That you are not falling means there must be no net force acting on you. The ground must be exerting an upward force on you that precisely cancels the downward force you exert on your chair. The fact that the downward force you exert on the ground is offset by an equal and opposite force that pushes upward is an example of Newton's third law. For any force, there is always an equal and opposite reaction force. Newton's third law explains how a rocket works. A rocket engine generates a force that drives a hot gas out of the back, which creates an equal and opposite force that propels the rocket forward. Newton discovered the basic law that describes how gravity works. He elegantly used mathematics to describe the force of gravity in his universal law of gravitation. Three simple statements summarize gravity. First, every mass attracts every other mass. Second, that attraction is directly proportional to the product of the masses. And third, the attraction is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between their centers. Mathematically, all three statements can be combined into a single equation. It says that the force of gravity, Fg, is equal to the product of the masses of two objects, m1 and m2, divided by the distance between them squared. The symbol g is a constant called the gravitational constant. Gravity is an inverse square law. The force decreases with the square of the distance. Move the objects twice as far away, and the force decreases by 4. Move them 3 times as far away, and the force decreases by 9. By the time Newton published his Principia in 1687, Kepler's laws of planetary motion had already been known and tested for about 70 years. Kepler's laws were so successful that there was little doubt about their validity. However, there was debate about why they worked so well. Newton resolved the debate by showing that Kepler's laws are consequences of the laws of motion and, in particular, the universal law of gravitation. With the aid of mathematics and calculus, Newton showed that Kepler's laws apply to all orbiting objects, not just planets. Also, ellipses are not the only possible orbital paths. Ellipses, which include circles, are the only possible shapes for bound orbits, but objects can also follow unbound orbits. These are paths that bring an object close to another object just once. Some comets, for example, follow unbound orbits. They come from afar just once, loop around the sun, and then never return. We usually think of one object orbiting another object, like a planet orbiting the sun, but Newton showed two objects attracted by gravity actually orbit around their common center of mass, or the point at which the two objects would balance if they were somehow connected. For example, in a binary star system with which both stars have the same mass, we would see both stars tracing ellipses around a point halfway between them. When one object is more massive than the other, the center of mass lies closer to the more massive object. The idea that objects orbit their common center of mass holds even for the sun and the planets. It's just that our sun is so much more massive that the center of mass between the sun and planets lies inside the sun. Left undisturbed, planets and everything else would keep the same orbits forever and ever. Orbits cannot change spontaneously, but they can change through exchanges of energy. One way that two objects can exchange orbital energy is through a gravitational encounter, in which they pass near enough so each can feel the effects of the other's gravity. For example, in the rare case in which a comet happens to pass near a planet, the comet's orbit can change dramatically. This figure shows a comet headed towards the sun on an unbound orbit. The comet's close passage by Jupiter allows the comet and Jupiter to exchange energy. Spacecraft engineers use this idea in reverse. For example, on its way to Pluto, the New Horizons spacecraft was deliberately sent past Jupiter on a path that allowed it to gain energy at Jupiter's expense. This extra orbital energy boosted the spacecraft's speed. Without the boost, it would have needed an extra 4 years to reach Pluto. Friction can also cause objects to lose orbital energy. For satellites orbiting Earth, if the orbit is low, the satellite will experience drag from Earth's thin atmosphere at this point. This drag will gradually cause the satellite to lose energy until it finally plummets towards the Earth. If we give a spacecraft enough orbital energy, it may end up in an unbound orbit that allows it to escape Earth completely. Although it would probably make more sense to say that the probe achieves escape energy, we instead say that it achieves escape velocity. Escape velocity does not depend on the mass of the escaping object, but it does depend on whether you start from the surface or from someplace high above the surface. Because gravity weakens with distance, it takes less energy and a lower velocity to escape from a point high above the Earth's surface. Okay, we have covered a lot in this lecture, but that's it. Take a break, get a cappuccino, you certainly deserve it, and I will talk to you soon.